Good morning. Welcome to our webinar, Clean Up Your Samples, a new sorbent to remove food matrix interferences. This event, brought to you by Food Safety Magazine, is sponsored by Waters. I'm your moderator, Barbara Van Renterham, editorial director of the magazine. Thank you for joining us. Today's presenter is Jeremy Shea, PhD, marketing manager for the Consumables Business Unit at Waters. Jeremy received his PhD in chemistry from the University of Massachusetts Lowell. He has worked in environmental testing laboratories, performing contaminant analysis in all types of sample matrices, and as an analytical scientist in a pharmaceutical company. Jeremy previously served as a senior applications chemist responsible for sample prep development for food testing and food safety. He has published application notes for melamine analysis in infant formula and multi-residue pesticide analysis in fruits and vegetables using the Ketcher's method. He has performed carbohydrate, vitamin, and multi-residue analyses of veterinary drugs, pesticides, and mycotoxins in various food matrices. Before we begin today's presentation, I would like to provide you with a few housekeeping items. To the right of your screen, you will see a taskbar. Each icon on this bar is assigned to a particular element of today's webinar. If you are unsure about what an icon does, hover your mouse over the icon and a box will pop up that tells you its function. A copy of today's presentation can be downloaded from the handouts icon. After the presentation, a survey will pop up on the screen, and we would appreciate you taking some time to provide us feedback about today's event. Next to the slides window, there is a blank question box that allows you to type a question in the box and hit the submit button to send it to us. At the end of the live program, our presenter will address as many of your questions as possible, but you can send them at any time throughout the presentation. If you would like to schedule an appointment with today's sponsor, Waters, please click the Schedule an Appointment button and fill out a brief survey. Today's event is being recorded and will be archived on our website, www.foodsafetymagazine.com. All registered participants will receive an email within 1 to 2 business days with a link to view a recording of the event on demand. And now I'm excited to turn today's presentation over to Jeremy Shea.
Thank you, Barbara, and for the introductions. First of all, good morning, and thank you, everyone, participating in today's webinars. Today, we're going to try to introduce you a new solvent, which will be used for the cleanup of the meat and milk extract prior to the multi-residue veterinary drugs analysis before the LC and the tandem mass spec analysis. Today's agenda is as follows. First, we're going to discuss why food safety testing is important, and then what are the considerations for the sample preparations. And then following that, we will introduce you the new solvent, which is called Oasis Prime HOB. We will showing you, demonstrate what is the prime HOB is. And after that, we're going to show a few examples of the actual applications of using the prime HOB for the cleanup of meat and milk extracts before the LC-MSMS analysis. And finally, we'll give a brief summary. There are three major drivers for increased food safety testing these days. The first driver is regulations. There are more and more surveillance national monitor programs for the import and export food products. The second driver is the economic. In the marketplaces, food companies are more and more would like to differentiate their brand from others. And they are also increase the consumer prosperities so that they have the greater choice, greater competitions. And the Green Lobby always focus on the organic and the sustainability of environment. The last drivers, which is probably the most important ones, is the public scrutiny and the media coverage. And whenever there's a food crisis, The food companies would like to protect their brands by doing more food testing. And also during the food scare, BSE, for example, so-called Mercator disease, dioxins, antibiotics, mycotoxins. Whenever the food scare, there is always increased food safety testing. And unfortunately, in certain cases, there may be adulterations. For example, we might see example in the wine, the orange juice, olive oil. And back in 2008, in China, and there is a melamine crisis in the infant formulas, if you recall. So what are the substances that could pose risk, which we are doing the food testing? And there are two main categories. The first category is the contamination in the field. And these are the environmental contaminants, such as dioxins, PCBs, and metals. Also, we could have some natural toxic substances, such as mycotoxins, phycotoxins, and plant toxins. If we are concerned about our fruit and vegetables, and we always concern about the pesticide residues, if they are animal products, animal food, and then similarly, we're concerned about the veterinary drugs residues. The contaminations could also take in place during the food processing process, and these are processing contaminants. For example, we could have some additives, such as illegal dyes could be introduced, and also some packaging material could migrate during the process. And in the case of genetic modified organisms, people always would like to know the authenticities and the traceability of the food we'll consume. In the last case, in the cases, for example, like melamines, these are deliberate adulterations. There are many challenges scientifically in food safety testings. The number one challenging is the sensitivities. We're required to accurately identify and contaminate in a very wide variety of sample matrices. And the regulatory agency are continuously pushing to have a better and lower detection limits for their methods. And there's also always have new emerging contaminants that will require very sensitive instrumentations and the methodologies. And whenever there's a food crisis, food scares, there's hundreds and thousands of samples coming into the laboratories. And all these samples need to be analyzed and turn around with the results in a very short period of time. And not only that, the methods we use for doing the testing have to be rugged and they have to be very reliable. Because in the cases that sometimes we're gonna see some co-eluting endogenous materials that can result in the reduce the assay accuracies. And lastly, the data quality must be maintained, so that we can have make better and more informed decisions. So people might ask, why do we need to do sample preparation? Would it be better if we don't need to do any sample preparations? Unfortunately, that is not the case. So the number one reason for sample preparation is we need to remove the matrix interferences so that we can increase the signal-to-noise ratio by simplifying the chromatography separations so that we can have a better and a more consistent quantitations. And also the matrix interference has been reduced, then we can also reduce the variabilities in the analytical results due to these inconsistencies from the matrices so that we can have a higher and more consistent recovery by reducing, minimize the matrix effects, and that will have less rework. And also, by removing these interferences, we can increase the column lifetimes. That means the field columns need to be replaced during the sample testings. That could also reduce the cost of analysis. So not only the column lifetime can be saved, and also we can reduce the possible system downtimes. So the analyst will spend more time doing the actual testing rather than spending time trying to fix, repair. In the worst scenario, it could have the instrument could be down waiting for the service to come. The second reason for doing sample preparation is frequently we may need to concentrate the analytes of interest. So these contaminants are present at very low level in the sample matrices. So frequently we need to do a sample enrichment in able to be able to detect these analytes. So the last reason for the sample prep is sometimes we need to transfer these analytes of interest into a solution that can be tested. For example, if we sample was tested in the was extracted by using organic solvents, and frequently we use the LCMS reverse phase as a detection technique, and then we need to convert it or dilute these extracts so that can be injected onto the LCMS columns. When we talk about sample preparation, what we try to do is turn these samples showing here. They could be the sample in the test tubes, could be milk sample, could be meat, could be plasma or food blood samples. And we're trying to turn those into sample extracts and that can be analyzed to give a very good separation chromatograms. There are many preparation techniques we use. So which one should we use? And here we listed several different techniques. They are in the order of the more step and complexities of the sample preparation techniques, and also that roughly is the same order of how clean your sample extracts are expected to be. And the first and the most easiest ones, if you have aqueous solutions, aqueous sample, you can just simple filtration and dilutions. But frequently that's not sufficient, so you may have to use the protein precipitations, and that will give you better cleanup. And next one is the liquid-liquid extractions. In the case of multi-residue pesticide analysis, there's a well-known CATRIS method, which stands for quick, easy, cheap, effective, rugged, and safe. These are very good dispersive SB sample cleanup. And last resort, which is the solid phase extractions, but this can give you the best cleanup possible. So the overall objective for all these sample prep technique is we're trying to have the simplest technique. We can have the preparation procedure as sure as possible, but still we're able to get the cleanest extracts possible. And this is the objective, the goal. But in reality, frequently what we have is we're trying to do with just a good enough sample preparation. Most of the analytical method can be grouped into two types. One is the compound or class specific, as shown in the right columns, or they could be the multi-residue, multi-class methods. And we look at these method requirements for the entire procedures. For the multi-residue method, typical these are generic because we have to deal with the, a very diverse set of analytes. They could have very different properties among different classes. On the other hand, when we're dealing with one compound of one class of compound, which have very similar properties, we can make sure the entire procedure be very specific, fine-tuning for that set of compounds. So the sample preparation protocol, typical for multi-residue, are very simple, typical not more than two steps, and a specific method obviously will have multiple steps in order to get the best cleanup possible. So the goal of the sample cleanup for the multi-residue, the number one goal is the speed. As a result of that, sometimes the recovery and the cleanup may be compromised, again, due to the large numbers of analytes involved. And the compound-specific methods could have the maximized recovery and matrix cleanup, and so we can minimize interferences in the case of LCMS could be lead to ion suppressions, so can be reduced. So the level of cleanup, obviously, for multi-residue typically are moderate or very minimal. In the cases of a specific method, clearly the sample cleanup are maximized. As a result of that, so this kind of method that can allow us to use the single quad mass spec or the optical detection such as UV fluorescence, EOS or GCFID or single quad MS. And for the multi-residue methods, so typical we use a tandem mass spec, time of flight, this could be LC or GCMS. And GC typically will require the higher level of sample cleanup, even in the cases of multi-residue analysis. And here, we're going to introduce the Oasis Prime HLB. As shown in the pictures, there are three types of devices. They are microevolution plates, and they are 96-well plates, and we also have three different sizes of cartridges, and they are 1cc, 3cc, and 6cc's. So what is Oasis Prime HLB? What is the prime the name stands for? So the letter I stands for improvements in the process of sample preparations, and the method is very robust. And also, it's very capable of removing the matrix effects. And the protocol and the device is very easy to use. If we're going to describe what the Oasis Prime HLB in three simple words, and what are the benefits, and they are simpler, faster, and cleaner. And here in the next few slides, we'll explain a little bit more in details. So Oasis Prime HLB is a reverse phase, solid phase extraction device, and it's a patent pending, and it's designed to simplify the solid phase extractions. So the protocol is very easy, but we still result in the very clean samples. And compared to the traditional SPE process, which consists of five steps, this Oasis Prime HLB does not require the conditioning and the equilibration steps. And so it's very easy to implement into the laboratory workflows, and the analyst does not require to be an SPE expert. Here we're showing a three-step protocol, which we call catch and release. So there are three steps involved. The step one is a loading step. So we will load the pre-treated, in this case, is aqueous samples. So in this, during this step, the analytes of interest being retained are being catched by the Oasis Prime. And the next step followed by the wash with 5% methanols. And the analytes still stay on the cartridge, and the matrix being further washed away. And the last step, the analytes being eluted by using a high organic solvent, which is 90-10 acetonitrile methanols. So this protocol is a generic protocol, and the wash and elution step can be adjusted if needed based on the analyzer interest. And these are more suitable for the compound and a single class specific analysis. And here we have a drug panel mixtures consist of 9 different compounds, and they have a very wide range of the properties. Some were acidic, some were basic, some were neutral, indicated by the pKa values. And also they have a wide range of the hydrophobicities, indicated by the log P, starting from 0.05 and all the way up to 5. And also this drug has a wide range of indications, as indicating in the comments columns. And here's the chromatogram of the separation of 9 drugs, as showing in the very nicely baseline separations. Let's take a look at the recovery and the matrix effect. As here is shown, the recovery is represented by by the blue columns, and the matrix effect are expressed by the red columns, which is a very small, very near to zero. So as you can see here, all the analytes, all 9 analytes, has the recovery in the high 80s. And the matrix effects are very low, all of them are less than 15%, by using this very simple three-step protocols. And also, here we're showing the reproducibility of the Oasis Prime. And here we're showing we're using 5 different batches of Oasis Prime cartridge. And then we have 9 different compounds, and they have been repeated five times, you can see the numbers of recovery are very tight. So we have a very good batch-to-batch reproducibility of Oasis Prime. So as I mentioned, these type of catch-release three-step protocol are more suitable for the compound or class-specific methods. And next, I'm going to introduce the even much more simpler than the three-step. And here we're showing a pass-through protocol consists of two steps. So the step one is a load and a collect step, which is different than the previous catch and release. In this case, the samples are in the very high organic, typically acetonitrile samples, such as meat or milk extracts. And then in this case, the analytes of interest are not retained by the sorbent. They are actually passing through and being collected in the bottom of the test tubes. And the interferences, such as fat and the phospholipids, are actually being retained by the Oasis Prime. And step number two is optional. You can further rinse more of the analytes off to be collected at the bottom, but it is optional. So this pass-through protocol is mostly suitable for multi-class compound analysis, such as multi-residue veterinary drugs analysis. And this will be demonstrated the actual application in the next sections. And here's an example of the milk sample. And here we have 60 compounds from 9 different drug classes. As you can see here, with a 5 replica sample analysis, we have a very tight percent RSD, or less than 20%, and the recovery rate is ranging from 70 to 120%. And this pass-through protocol, as I mentioned, is the most suitable for the multi-residue, multi-class methodologies. And here we're showing the Oasis Prime is making the process much faster. As you can see here, this was done by because the faster flow rate. And here we compare the Oasis Prime HOB with HOB, and both devices have the same exact format. And here we can see there are three different type format. They are microelution plates, and there are two different type simple solvents of the 96 well plates. There are three different size of cartridge, and there are three different type of sample matrices that were tested here. They are plasma, urine, and milk samples. If you look at the far right corners, if you compare the speed of flow rates, compare prime to the HOB, and typically you have a minimum of a 2 times faster flow rate, and could be as high as 6 times faster. So prime is way faster, could be faster than HOB. So the third benefit is the extract will be even cleaner. If we're using the generic three-step protocol, which I call catch and release, we're able to remove more than 90% of common matrices interferences, such as salts, proteins, and phospholipids. If we're using the generic protocols or the pass-through protocols, if you compare to the Oasis HOB, we can remove at least 90% more of the phospholipids. So we talk a lot about the phospholipids. Why is phospholipids important? And what is phospholipids? And obviously, from the name, it's one group of lipids. If you look at the structure of the molecules, which is shown on the left, a little cartoon, we have a phosphate group, which is the hydrophilic head, and we also have a two fatty acids tail, and these are hydrophobic tails. When you have both of the hydrophilic and hydrophobic functional group on the same molecule, these are the amphipathic compounds, which means they could have the surfactant-like properties. And the phospholipids serve as a major structural component in the most biologic membranes. And in the cell membrane of the organisms, and they will form lipid bilayers. And most the noticeable famous of the phospholipids we know is lecithin. And these can be frequently found in the animal and the plant tissues. For example, we have find those in the egg yolks, milk, soybeans, and some of the animal cells. So the phospholipid buildup can lead to matrix effect and unpredictable results. And here we show an example of 50 continuous injections of a sample, which is a simple protein precipitation without further cleanups. As you can see on the right-hand side, there are two chromatograms. On the top, chromatogram A, which is the first injection of this protein precipitation. And we are monitoring the total phospholipids. As you can see here, there are three major groups of phospholipids. If you look at the bottom, a chromatogram B, if you look at the blue trace, and that is the phospholipids on the number 50 injection, you can see clearly there's a buildup of the phospholipids on the columns. And also, if you look at the far right, at a retention time roughly 2.5 minutes, in the first injections, the whole phospholipid almost complete or elute, but in the case of number 50, there hasn't been completed elute of the columns. So if you overlap the target analyzer interest, which I'm showing in the chromatogram B, if you overlap with the phospholipids, you can see clearly, especially in the second compound on the right, which is called chlorpidogrel, and that clearly has a major overlapping with the phospholipids. So this could lead to the possible matrix effect or ion suppressions, and this could lead to a decrease on the method robustness. So it's important to remove the phospholipid, especially in the cases of LC-MSMS analysis. So here's a short summary about Oasis Prime HOB. This is the next generation SP device, and that sets a new performance standards for the routine analysis, especially for the, we will demonstrate in the veterinary drugs analysis. This is the best choice for the samples that will contain proteins, fats, maybe a lipids, and it can be prepared by the reverse phase catch and release, the three-step protocol, or can be used the cleanup by using the so-called pass-through SP cleanup. And there are three major benefits of using Oasis Prime. So the protocol is much more simpler, streamlined, there's no conditioning or equilibration step are required, and it very easily can be implemented into the lab workflow without the SP expertise. And the total process is much faster due to the faster flow rate through the devices. And we have a very even flow rate across both platform cartridges or plates with less plugging. And the extract is much more cleaner because the matrix effects been reduced. Both phospholipids and fats have been removed either through the pass-through protocol or the three-step protocols. As a result of that, we can have less column or instrument downtime due to the contaminations. Here we're going to show some few examples of using Oasis Prime. So these days, the residue analysis for veterinary drugs typical are, as showing here, an example of method used by USDA. And these are all single or classes of veterinary drugs. So each class is, or that group of compounds are being analyzed using separate methods. So here we're showing seven different classes. So we are talking about seven separate sample prep and a seven separate LC-MS analysis. By using Oasis Prime HOB, and we can combine all these seven analyses into one single prep and one LC-MSMS analysis. So when we try to perform the multi-residue analysis, the challenging is try to create a single extraction method, and that will be good for all different classes. And we are talking about very diverse compound diversities, and they have a large numbers, groups, and classes, and they all have very different physical chemical properties, such as polarities, pKa's, and frequently we have to test both the parent drugs and their metabolites. And also the matrix is very complex. We frequently have the matrix effect coming from proteins, fats, or phospholipids or salt in the samples. In sometimes certain cases, we have the concern about possible protein bindings. In the cases of milk analysis, we have the concern about the chelating effect. In the cases of tetracycline and the similar products, they could form the bonds with the calcium, which is present in the milk samples. So what are the composition of milk and meat samples? Obviously, in the cases of milk, mostly composition is waters and could be as high as 85%. And there are 14% solids left. And within those solids, 4% of those are fats and also could have as high as 1% phospholipids and 4% proteins and have some sugar in the form of a lactose. If we look at the pork compositions, depending on the cut of the pork, but the majority of the composition is still waters, could be as high as 70%. And there are 30% solids. Within those solids, about 5 to 20% are fats, and up to 3% are phospholipids, which is clearly much higher than the milk samples. And we could have typical has 15 to 20% are proteins. So both fat and phospholipids, these two major components, typical co-interference with the LCMS analysis, and the Oasis Prime is very capable of removal both matrices from the sample. Here are some of the major classes of the veterinary drugs. As we're showing here, we have a tetracycline, a fluoroquinolones, sulfonamides, macrolides, beta-lactam, steroid, and amphenicols, and some beta-adrenergic samples. As you're showing here on the structures of these compounds, they have multiple functional groups. Some are acidic, some could be basic, as indicated by the pKa values. And also, some of these could have very high water solubility, and some of them are not as soluble. And these are indicated by the hydrophobicities in the log P. So we really talk about very complex and very high range variety of compounds. They have a very typical properties. So that's why making the multi-residue veterinary drug analysis so difficult. The typical, there is a different strategy for the sample extractions. The first strategy typical you will see is the precipitation extraction by using the strong buffers. For example, make Ivan's buffers and followed by the SB cleanup. So this strategy is very good for the tetracyclines, beta-adrenergics, and polar sulfonamides. And for the fluoroquinolones, the extraction recovery is fair, but unfortunately for the most other compounds, the recovery is very poor. So the other method could be UC strategy is the precipitation and extraction by using 3-to-1 ratio of acidic acetonitrile and followed by the SB cleanup. So this you can give you the very excellent protein precipitations. But unfortunately, for tetracycline, beta-adrenergic compounds, polar sulfonamides, the recovery is very low. But for most of the others, are much better than the first strategy. Here we're showing some typical recovery from milk samples. We compare different type of the precipitation extraction techniques. And here we show the six major classes, ranging from tetracycline, could be very water soluble, and polar, and to the very non-polar steroid samples classes. If you look at the first column, these are the 3-to-1 ratio of acetonitriles. So tetracyclines and the beta-adrenergic compounds, the recoveries are very low, less than 25%. And the other compounds are a little bit better. If we're using the aqueous buffers, and pretty much the opposite is the tetracyclines and beta adrenergic samples, these has much better recovery rates. But the other compounds, the non-polar ones, such as steroid, fall below 50%. And the far right column, which is the one-to-one sample dilution with the acetonitrile, which this one won't have as effective protein precipitations. But if you look at the recovery rates, they're okay. They're ranging from 50 to 80%. The only exception is the tetracycline has much lower extractions recovery rates. And this one-to-one milk sample compared to the acetonitrile is very similar to the so-called catcher's approach. So why not using catchers for sample preparation for veterinary drugs? There are some pros and cons by using catchers, and here we're showing some few points. So some classes of vet drugs has very good recoveries by using the catchers methods, such as ivermectins, but unfortunately, too many other classes has very low recovery, as low as below 50%. So the first step, the vet drug extractions are similar, but however, in the cases of pesticide analysis, the salt was added to it, and typical for vet drugs, the salt was not added. And also, the pesticide typical are generally much more nonpolar and less water soluble compared to the vet drugs. So as a result of that, so when the salt is added to the acetonitrile and water's mixtures, and we will form a, what we call salting out and the liquid-liquid partitioning. In this steps, most, about 80% of the pesticide are partitioned into the top acetonitrile layers. But compare, if you're using the same exact protocols, majority of the vet drugs, or I should say larger portions of veterinary drugs actually are partitioned into the bottom water layers. Typical sample extraction for vet drugs are showing on this slide, whether they are milk sample or the tissues. If it's a milk sample, the 1 mL samples is mixing with 4 mL acidified of acetonitriles. So the ratio of the milk to the acetonitrile is roughly 20 to 80%. If it's tissue samples, we typically use 2.5 grams, and these are extracted by using 10 mL of 0.2% formic acid in the 80-20 acetonitrile water. So if you look at the ratio between acetonitrile and waters, in both cases are roughly 80-20% of the ratio. By using this ratio, we'd be able to provide a good recovery for most analytes. And by doing this step extraction, we were able to remove proteins, sugars, and salts. And after the extractions, the centrifugation step was taking place, and we can take the top supernatant ready for the next step, which is the pass-through SPE cleanup. In the past, before Oasis Prime, the pass-through was done by using the C18, such as CEPET C18 type of cartridge. So by doing the simple pass-through, this step will be able to remove fats and other nonpolar pigments. But by using Oasis Prime, not only remove fats and the nonpolar components, and also the phospholipids are also being removed. So in this type of pass-through cleanups, the cartridges is working like a chemical filtration. So in this step, we are using just one simple, one step, the pass-through steps. The wash step is not required. And here's a more detailed sample preparation procedures. If it's a milk sample, as I showed before, as 1 mL milk, add a 4 mL of the formic acid in the acetonitrile after mixing and the centrifugation step, and then we take the supernatant for the SPE cleanup. If the sample is the tissues, we will weigh out 2.5 grams, homogenize the tissues, and extract it by using 10 mL of the 80-20 CO nitrile water, which is certified with the 0.2% formic acid. And the pass-through step in this case is if we're using the 3cc cartridge, approximately 0.5 mL of supernatant was passed through the OSS prime cartridge and then collect at the bottom. And we take 0.3 mL of that extract and we dilute it 1 to 3, threefold using the ammonium formate buffers before the ALC analysis. And typically, the exact portion of the pass-through fractions, we can evaporate it, we can concentrate the samples, or just simply as we show in here, the dilutions, it all depends on the sensitivity of the instrumentation. And here's the UPLC conditions. The I-class was used for this studies, and the UPLC CSH C18 column we used, and formic acid was used in both mobile phase A and B. The maximum use for this study is the Waters Zevo TQS. All the compounds are the electrical spray positive except the negative for the chlorophenicol. And we have seen this slide before. In this case, this is the milk samples. We have up to 9 different classes of 60 compounds. Here, let's look at the phospholipid removal effect from the milk samples. You see the top chromatograms, which is just the milk sample after process by the protein precipitations. As you can see here, with a very high majority amount of a phospholipid still left in the samples. I'm taking this extract and pass through with the OASIS prime, as you can see in the bottom chromatograms, and most phospholipids have been removed. The next sample we can see here is the shrimp extract. And similarly, we can monitor the phospholipids. There are three major peaks here. After the cleanup by a prime HLB, and almost 95% of those have been removed. Let's look at the salmon tissues. And here we have 9 different classes of drugs. There are a total of 23 compounds here, and we can see here the recurrence rates are ranging from 60 to about 100%, with one exception, which are for roughly 50%, which is the phenobutazones. We see the similar recovery result for the shrimp tissues. We see very similar trends. So these recovery are what we call total method recovery, which means the recovery is calculated. The sample is subject to two-step, both the extractions and the SV cleanup. So if you look at the result of recovery by groups, the method recovery is typical about roughly average about 80%, which range between 50 to 100%. If you look at classes, penicillin class usually about 70%, sulfonamides better about 85%, fluoroquinolones is about 75%, and tetracycline typical has a much lower recovery, which is about 40% or less. So the question is, are these recovery, low recovery, recovery loss, are these caused by the path through the SB cleanup? To answer these questions, and we do the following experiment. So we'll take the salmon, the blank extract, and then we spike with the vet drugs just before the SPE steps. And we'll let it pass through the SPE, and we compare the recovery to the post-spike of samples. So this sample is only subject to the pass-through cleanup, which is what we call the pass-through recoveries calculations. As showing in the bottom graph, and these are showing the red columns. And the blue one is the overall, what we call method recovery, which is subject to both extractions and the pass-through cleanups. As you can see here, almost all the SP recovery are near 100%. For example, if you look at the amoxicillins on the all the way to the left, the pass-through cleanups almost 100%, but the overall, the method recovery is about 60%. So the low recovery overall method is due to the first step, which is the extraction step. So the extraction efficiency frequently is the major factor of determining the overall method recovery rates. So in the case of tetracyclines, as we've shown before, the recovery is much lower, typical 40% or less. There are several different options if tetracyclines is a very important compounds of target analyzed interest. As I'm showing here, the three different options. A is, okay, based on the method validation results, we can build concentration factors when we consider them to report the levels. And then we can perform the confirmation test if needed whenever we have a positive hit. So option B is we can take the tetracycline out of the list of the screening methods. So we will treat tetracycline alone by itself. So we'll test and also analyze the tetracycline using the individual analytical methods. And for example, here we're showing the sum of step for tetracycline if it's in the cases of milk samples, because the tetracycline are the strong chelating reagents. So typical EDTA or oxalic acid is added to the buffer to sequester the calcium binding and followed by the OASIS MAX cleanup. So the last option C is we can extract the sample again the second time and using the optimized method for the tetracyclines. And then we'll combine the both the extract together. But before we pass through to the prime HLB, we need to adjust the acetonitrile level. We need to adjust to be closer to 80%. Then we can let it pass through the OASIS prime HLB. But this options, the advantage is that you will further dilute the extract and also make the increase the aqueous content of the extract. So if you need to do the evaporations, it will be much more difficult. So the overall summaries, the worldwide regulatory requirements are expanding to include more and more compounds. In the case of the pesticides, and routinely people are screening about 40% or 400 pesticides or more. In the case of the veterinary drugs, people would like to screen 100% or more. So there's a need for the good multi-residue screening methods to meet all these regulatory limits. We need to maximize numbers of compounds and with the minimum numbers of method possible for the multi-residue screening. In the case of the pesticide, we have a catcher's method, and hopefully by using prime HLB, we demonstrate they will be similar. It can be used for multi-residue screening for the veterinary drugs. So prime HLB in the pass-through protocol is operate as a chemical filters. So the major interferences are being retained by the solvents, and the analytes are actually passing through. And prime HLB has been shown very effective remove the majority of fatty matrix and phospholipids from both milk and the tissue samples, and then give the cleanest possible sample matrices before performing the multi-residue veterinary analysis, and typically using LC-MSMS. Thank you very much for your attention, and this is the end of my presentation. I'm welcoming to answer all of your questions.
Well, thank you, Jeremy, for a great presentation. Now we're going to turn to some of the questions that have been submitted throughout your presentation. The first one I have is, at the end you showed the difference in recovery and the recovery loss was primarily due to the extraction. One could argue to not even bother doing the extraction and instead just do your prime HLB method. What would you say the advantages are to doing the extraction procedure in addition?
Frequently, for example, if we talk about the food sample in the cases, for example, using pork as examples, so the veterinary drugs residue are present in the samples. So you have to do some sort of extraction in order to be able to get it out of the matrices. So the sample prep, which is most of the time, and the food matrices are something of necessities. You can't really avoid that. The only question now is for multi-residue analysis, what is the best to optimize or compromise single extraction method you should use? What we recommend here is using a roughly 80-20, which is the best compromise we think to be able to get most of the classes out of the matrices.
Sure, that sounds like the smart way to do it, to optimize what you're looking for. We have a question asking if you have tried to clean up any solid food samples, and if so, what pretreatment or solvent would you recommend?
As I'm showing here, in the case of solid, if you talk about tissues, it's just a typical what you do. You will homogenize the samples, and then you weigh out. In the case of support, we demonstrate we typical recommend using 2.5 grams, and you do extract with you 10 mil of the 80-20 single nitrile water and certified by the 0.2% formic acid. And that by doing that, you can you also doing the protein precipitation, and also you extract the analytes out of the matrices.
Another question is the Oasis Prime capable of reducing polyphenols or tannins?
Paula, that's a good question. I have to think about that. I at this moment, I wasn't able to answer that. Polyphenols. If they are very polar, and then probably it's not suitable for the Oasis Prime, because the step number one, remember, we're using 80-20s. So if it's polar analyzed, the extraction infusion is going to be extremely low. So if you couldn't get it out of the matrices, it doesn't matter whether you can pass through, clean up or not, because you won't be able to get it out of the matrices.
Okay. Can someone use the Oasis Prime HLB in the protocol for aminoglycosides?
That's a perfect example, which I mentioned. Aminoglycoside is relatively polar, and the extraction efficiency, which is very limited, what we recommend here, 80-20. So for aminoglycoside, which will be one of the classes which will Oasis Prime won't be able to help too much. So in the cases like aminoglycoside, we'll recommend using the specific methods for that aminoglycoside alone.
Okay. During the pass-through protocol, you use 80-20 acetonitrile water as the solvent for both the extraction and solid phase steps. Can you use another solvent, such as methanol?
The issue with methanol, of our experiences, is if using methanols, and the cleanup effect of phospholipids won't be as significant. So, which means your extract will be more dirtier than using the acetonitrile.
Okay.
So you can use it, but the cleanup effect will be compromised.
Have you looked at, when you initially introduced the three-step protocol versus the pass-through, and you listed for the three-step a pre-treated sample, have you looked at other pre-treatments besides extraction?
That would probably depend on what sample matrix we're talking about. It has to be matrix dependent. Without example, it's difficult. But we initially, when we developed this, the first analyze we're looking at is veterinary drugs. So we're looking at typical our tissue sample, milk, these general matrices, which people are concerned about the residues of veterinary drugs. But certainly, these Oasis Prime it can be used to target other type of target analytes. For example, we are looking at the, for example, pesticide. If you need to testing pesticides and you could use Oasis Prime. The other possible residue we're looking at is the mycotoxins that can be used as well.
Okay. What is the minimum percentage of acetonitrile to use with the OASIS Prime?
If we talk about the pass-through protocols, as we show an example, for both the step one, which is the extraction step, we find the best optimized ratio is 80-20 acetonitrile water, and that happened to be the best ratio for the second step, which is for the pass-through OASIS Prime cleanup. So if you do the calculations, so you typically, in the cases of pass-through protocol, you want to make sure the overall, if you do the calculation with the water percentage in your samples, you want to make sure the acetonitrile, you don't want to be lower than 70%. That's the lowest you can get. You know, anything lower than that and the cleanup effect is going to be a minimum.
One more question. You focus a lot on the phospholipids. Are there other macromolecules that interfere just as much that one should be concerned about?
Yes. Anything which has a similar chemical, physical property similar to phospholipids, as I show in some of the slides, remember you have the surfactant type of properties. You have the the hydrophobic and hydrophilic portions. Anything interferences which has that kind of similar properties, and that can be cleaned up using OASIS Prime.
Have you looked at beverage analysis in addition to different like tissue matrices?
We have not, but it should be similar to what we we use for the milk samples. Actually, the matrix is depend on what the beverage it is. If we talk about like say soda or maybe energy drinks or something, it would be similar to milk sample. But in the case of energy drink, probably will have much more higher amount of the sugars in some of the cases. We have very high contents of caffeines in there. So that may pose some challenges, but the basic principle would be very similar. Should be able to apply here too.
Okay. Doesn't look like we have any other questions at this time. Some thank yous coming in your way. This concludes today's webinar. Please join me in thanking Jeremy Shia for his presentation, as well as our sponsor, Waters. At the very end, a survey will pop up on the screen, and we invite you to take a few moments to provide us some feedback so we can help serve you better. If you have any additional questions or comments, please don't hesitate to contact me at Barbara@foodsafetymagazine.com. Please view our website for an archive of this presentation as well as information about our upcoming events. We appreciate your time today and hope you have found this webinar to be a valuable experience.